Good morning.
Recording in progress.
Welcome. Welcome to Axe Church. We're glad you're here. Join with me in prayer. Dear Lord, we praise you for this morning. We pray, Lord, that you will just guide us and lead us this morning. Lord, we continue to ask that you be our center, you be our guide, and you be the light that shines us through. We thank you for Christmas, that you came physically, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. So welcome. I hope you prepared for this week like I have. So I learned that church is a lot more filling when you're actually preparing during the week. So church, what we believe at Axe Church, that this Sunday should be the climax of your personal preparation throughout the week. And as we gather together to worship together, this should be the climax of what you've been doing in your personal time all week long, talking to him constantly, in his word, singing praises, hymns, and spiritual songs, and connecting with him. And when we come together here is when we celebrate together. We rejoice that Jesus came. And so as you came in today, you should have gotten a bulletin. On the bottom, you can actually rip off the Connect card. If you could fill that out or fill it out online, that would be appreciative. And put it in the offering basket or in the offering box. We get a hold of you. We're glad you're here. Thank you.
Well, good morning again. We're excited to be here. We're excited to be worshiping together in the presence of the Lord. And I just want to start with a couple of verses out of Exodus chapter 33. Moses is talking to the Lord, and he's asking God to send his presence before them because he knows that it is the presence of God that sets the people of God apart. And so listen to these words. The Lord said, "My presence shall go with you, and I will give you rest." And Moses said to the Lord, "If your presence does not go with us, do not lead us up from here. For how then will it be known that I have found favor in your sight, I and your people? Is it not by your going with us, so that I and your people may be distinguished from all the other people who are on the face of the earth?" Fast forwarding several thousand years to when God sent his son, Christ Jesus, into the world to be the Savior, to take away our sin. His presence set his people apart. When Christ returned to heaven in glory, he sent his Holy Spirit to be with his people, to set his people apart. So it is the presence of God that sets his people apart. So this morning as we worship him, we just want to worship that he came, that his presence is here. It is our identity and our distinguishing mark. And so we sing with joy to the world, for our Lord has come. Just invite you to stand with us as we worship him this morning. Holy Spirit, with your presence. And as we look to you, as we sing to you, God, as we hear from your word. In Jesus' name.
I will extol you, my God and King, and bless your name forever and ever. Every day I will bless you and praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall commend your works to another, and shall declare your mighty acts. On the glorious splendor of your majesty, and on your wondrous works, I will meditate. They shall speak of the might of your awesome deeds, and I will declare your greatness. They shall pour forth the fame of your abundant goodness, and shall sing aloud of your righteousness. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. The Lord is good to all, and his mercy is over all that he has made. All your works shall give thanks to you, O Lord, and all your saints shall bless you. Psalm 145, 1 through 10. Today, we light the candle of joy. There is no greater joy than to be in relationship with the one who is joy himself, Jesus Christ, the only uncreated one, perfect and holy, surrounded by the unspeakable glories of heaven, left his throne to take on the form of his creation and to become Emmanuel, God with us. He came that the Father would be glorified by his obedience. He came to offer himself as a sin offering once and for all. He came that we may have life. He came to wash away our sin and his blood and to robe us with his own righteousness. Because of Emmanuel, God with us, we can experience joy that nothing and no one can take away. Joy is established in the person of Jesus Christ and cannot be shaken by circumstance, trial, or fear. Neither can it be found in anything or anyone else. There is no substitute for true joy. Psalm 116:11 says, "In your presence there is fullness of joy." Jesus spoke to his disciples in John 15:11, saying, "These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be full." This Christmas, may the joy of Jesus' coming fill our hearts with unspeakable joy. He is Emmanuel, God with us.
Thank you, Rachel. So now we're going to worship through giving of tithes and offerings. So we have a basket, we have a box in the back. There's also QR codes you can give online or go to the website. Yeah, let's pray for this. Dear Lord, we thank you for the gifts that you've given us. We pray, Lord, that you will use the gifts that we give back to you, Lord. Lord, help us to worship while we give back to you what you've so graciously blessed us with. Lord, we pray that you will just continue just to use these funds to further your kingdom, to further Acts Church, and just the focus that you truly are alone, the one and only, the only way to salvation, the only glory. All praise belongs to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
To extol the Lord.
I will extol you, my God and King, and bless your name forever and ever. Every day I will bless you and praise your name forever and ever. So as we pray, to extol means to lift high, and the word bless means to humbly bow before him in humble adoration. So in the next few moments, just acknowledge that God is King, that he alone is high and exalted, and humble yourself before the exalted King. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall commend your works to another and shall declare your mighty acts. Our God cannot be described or explained or understood. He is beyond our comprehension. But he shows us glimpses of his glory through his works. So take some time now to thank him for his goodness, for his salvation, and for the ways that you personally have seen him at work in your life, even this week. On the glorious splendor of your majesty and on your wondrous works, I will meditate. They shall speak of the might of your awesome deeds, and I will declare your greatness. They shall pour forth the fame of your abundant goodness and shall sing aloud of your righteousness. God's works declare his splendor. So now thank him for his abundant goodness, his righteousness, his awesome deeds, his beauty, and ask him to open your ears to hear the song of his abundant goodness all around you. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. The Lord is good to all, and his mercy is over all that he has made. All your works shall give thanks to you, Lord, and all your saints shall bless you. Thank God for his grace and his mercy shown to us through Emmanuel, God with us. Thank him for his steadfast love, for his patience. Thank him for his presence with us. Just pray an offering of thanksgiving to him. We just thank you that where you are, there is fullness of joy, as your word says. That you've given us your word so that we can know who you are and abide in your presence and thereby be filled with joy. Lord, knowing the King of creation, the living God, the one and the only. God, I just pray that you would open our ears and open our eyes to hear and to see what you have to say in your word today. Lord, that we would be humble before you, that we would receive your word with joy and gladness, and allow you to do what you want to do in our lives this morning, Lord.
mark this place, mark this people with the presence of the living God. In Jesus' name.
Morning again and welcome. Slightly less nervous about this morning, being week two. We're glad you're here. If you're looking at the screen, it is December 11th, not December 4th. So don't want to get you confused. But welcome. We're glad you're here. We're glad to be in the house of the Lord this morning. And who's got their swords with them? There's some on the back if you need them. But open up the Word of the Lord with me. We're in John again this week. We're in John chapter 1. We were in the first half last week. We'll finish the rest of the chapter this week. Next week we'll be in John 6. And then Christmas Eve, our Christmas Eve service. We invite you. We want you to come. Christmas Eve, 4 p.m. here, Rice Lake Elementary School. And Christmas, which is the 25th, happens to be the 25th this year, it's always the 25th, there you go. But it's on a Sunday. We're going to do a Christmas Eve service. We're not going to do a Sunday morning service that week. But you should be in John chapter 1. I'm going to start reading verse 35. So the next day again, John was standing with two of his disciples. And he looked at Jesus, and he walked by and said, "Behold, the Lamb of God." The two disciples heard him say this, and they followed Jesus. Jesus turned and saw them following and said to them, "What are you seeking?" And they said to him, "Rabbi," which means teacher, "where are you staying?" He said to them, "Come and see. Come and you will see." So they came and saw where he was staying. And they stayed with him that day, for it was about the 10th hour. One of the two who heard John speak followed Jesus was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first found his own brother, Simon, and said to him, "We have found the Messiah," which means Christ. He brought him to Jesus. Jesus looked at him and said, "So you are Simon, the son of John. You shall be called Cephas," which means Peter. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, follow me. Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him of whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him and said to him, "Behold, an Israelite indeed, in whom there is no deceit." Nathanael said to him, "How do you know me?" Jesus answered him, "Before Philip called you, when you were under the fig tree, I saw you." Nathanael answered him, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus answered him, "Because I said to you, I saw you under the fig tree, do you believe? You will see greater things than these." And he said to him, "Truly, truly, I say to you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of God." Pray with me. Dear Lord, we praise you for your word. We pray, Lord, that you will just continue to help us to dig into your word. Help us to understand how alive and active this still is. Lord, we thank you that you came physically to earth, took the form of your creation, Lord, and we can look to you, for you alone bring salvation. But first you had to come. Lord, speak to us this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Always go dry. thanks. And so, as we talked about some last week, so we didn't know, we don't know a whole lot about Jesus before he turned 30, before he came on the scene with John. So we have his birth story, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and in John. Just remember, John doesn't have the nativity. There's no angels, just light and the Word. And as we're in here, we also see the story about when he was around 12 years old, when he was in the temple talking with, talking there with the leaders, when his family was on their way back from after the feast. But besides his birth, that short little story, we really don't know much about Jesus before he turned 30. And that's because he didn't want us to. So we know that we have, in the Word of God, what we need to know. And he gives us what we need to know. And so, at this time, there had been 400 years of silence. There had not been a prophet in the land of Israel. There's not been, God did not speak personally with any of them. But we know from John 17 that God's never not working. Even in the creation story, on day 7, it said he rested. He rested. It didn't say he stopped working. It didn't say he stopped being in control of everything. And so there are plenty of people who called themselves the Messiah at this time. Through that 400 years, there were several people who would rise up and say that they were the one, the coming one, who was told about in the scriptures. But they were all false. It wasn't until suddenly there was a voice of one crying out in the wilderness. Yes, that was John. We talked about John the Baptist last week. He was the son of Zechariah. It wasn't until he appeared. We read in Mark 1:4, John appeared, baptizing in the wilderness, and proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. So even John suddenly was on the scene. We're not sure how old John was. It probably wasn't much before Jesus was on the scene. We know John was there before because he was called to be the herald, the one to prepare the path in front of the Messiah, in front of the King. And when he was on the scene, he would say, and he would confess, he would not deny, but he would confess that he was not the Christ, and that he was not Elijah, and he was not the prophet. There was one coming that he didn't deserve to even untie his sandals. And when he uses this description, he says that he is the lowest of low. Untying the sandals, washing people's feet, that was the lowest servant's job. Because back in those days, they didn't have nicely paved streets. They didn't have nice shoveled driveways. The animals would be in the streets. And that John says that he didn't even deserve to be at that level. Yet, we read that Jesus calls John the greatest born of woman. Well, the greatest up to the point when Jesus is on the scene. And he is, and so he prepared the way. That John said that he wasn't the Christ. He was not this one. Now, John was esteemed and trusted by the Jewish leaders. That he was the credible witness used to testify of this coming Christ. So we pick up the narrative. Verse 35, it says, the next day. But, if you're counting days, this is the third day. Well, we think of Easter when we hear third day, don't you? Or the music group. Yeah. But, it's the third day. Should bring us to that scene of the resurrection. So verse 33, 35, as we pick up this narrative, The next day again, John was standing with two of his disciples, and he looked at Jesus as he walked by and said, "Behold, the Lamb of God." It's very interesting that John the Baptizer never actually called Jesus Messiah. Now, these two disciples were Andrew and John the Apostle, right? The one who wrote the book of John. And they started to follow him. And Jesus asked them, "What are you seeking?" And they said to him, "Rabbi, where are you staying?" So the word of God is so deep. So we can sit there and go word by word through Scripture, because each word is breathed out from God. And in it possesses the expanse of who he is. And so when we read this, it's interesting that they start by calling him Rabbi. Because Rabbi was a Jewish title of honor that literally meant "my great one," or "honored sir." We go around, "Good morning, sir." Now, we still use that type of position. So the Apostle John is giving us a lengthy explanation of what happened after Jesus said to them, "Come and you will see." For we never hear them call him by this title again. And actually, it's never used in the book of Luke. It's only used twice in the book of Matthew, and it revolves around the scene with Judas. So the initial calling Jesus Rabbi speaks that they didn't fully realize of who he was. So they were disciples of John. They had been sitting under John's teaching, and John had been saying he's preparing the way. But even in this, we see them a little skeptical. Is this really the Christ? And they start by calling him Rabbi. And that night, their opinion quickly changed. What did they talk about that night? What went on? What was that conversation? What did they see? We don't know. It's not written. It's not said. But truly, it shows that this is a relationship. This is not a religion. This is a relationship that actually takes place. So we pick back up in the narrative that both Andrew and John ran out to find their best friends. When you find good news, who do you go tell? Well, mom's sitting there saying, "I hope they come tell my mom." But usually you go tell your best friends first. Who were these guys' best friends? They're brothers. And so we have both of them. It only written here, but the way it's written indicates that they both ran out to get their brothers. And it says in there, it says that Andrew found his brother Simon. Before that, says first he found it. Now, John never refers to himself by name. And in here, he may just be giving a little bit of credit to Peter, because we think of that resurrection morning on that third day when Jesus rose from the dead. The same scene is in place. Peter and John are the ones running in this one. And John gets there first. Maybe this is a little nod to Peter saying, "Yeah, Andrew found you first, Peter, before I was able to find my brother James." He's connecting stories. There's so much into this that we can see that John's continuing to build to the climax of the resurrection. And so when Andrew found his brother Simon, he tells him that we have found the Messiah. He didn't say that we have found a good teacher. He didn't say, hey, we found this really cool guy who can do miracles. No. He, at this point, already says, we have found the Messiah. And when they came back to Jesus, Jesus shows his deity by calling Simon by name, showing that Jesus sees both body, heart, and soul. That Jesus said in verse 42, so you are Simon, the son of John. I like that it says so. I used to get yelled at for using so at the beginning of a sentence so much. But right here, so you are Simon, the son of John. You shall be called Cephas, which means Peter. And we read in Matthew 16, 18, and I tell you, you are Peter. And on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Jesus, at this very beginning, first introduction to Peter, knew that Peter was going to be the one to carry the church. He'd be the first real leader. We see that in Acts. We'll study that in January. And so verse 43 has us on day 4. It says the next day. So on this day, we read that they are going to Galilee, and the 4 disciples quickly turn into 6. So he found Philip and said to him, follow me. So Philip was from the same town as Andrew and Peter. Just like when Andrew and John believed that Jesus was the Christ, they ran out to tell their best friends right away. And just like with Philip ran out. He told his best friend, happened to be Nathanael. So Philip tells him, we have found him of whom Jesus in the law and all the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. Now we don't see Nathanael anywhere else. And we don't see Nathanael drop everything and run blindly and follow, do we? No, Nathanael, talking to Philip, says, can anything good come out of Nazareth? For there had probably been many people from Nazareth. Well, Nazareth wasn't that big a town. But there had probably been others who said that they were the Messiah. Because at this time, they were expecting the Messiah to be there, to come. So as he only mentioned here, Nathanael. Do you know Nathanael's not mentioned in any other gospel? He's not mentioned besides another at the end, the last chapter of John. So is this Nathanael a real person? He's not listed in any of the lists. Well, as he was here, we know that Nathanael was one of the 12. But he didn't always go by that name. So we can be assured that it is recognized that Nathanael is actually called Bartholomew elsewhere. And so Nathanael's name was most likely Nathanael Bartholomew. So this is Bart. So verse 47, Jesus saw Nathanael coming towards him and said to him, behold, an Israelite indeed, in whom there is no deceit. So Nathanael was shocked and said, how do you know me? Jesus answered him, before Philip called you, when you were under the fig tree, I saw you. Nathanael's address for Jesus quickly changes because he answers him, Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel. Now, Nathanael He obviously knew his Old Testament. He was obviously a man of the Word, constantly digging into Scripture. He obviously knew it, and that he studied it. Because we see Philip, when he first told him to come and see, that he said that he had found, not a teacher, but he had found the one in whom Moses and the prophets wrote. So obviously Nathanael knew Moses. He knew the prophets. He probably had them memorized. Nathanael's reaction to meeting Jesus got him tongue-tied. Because he starts off, Rabbi, Son of God, no, you're the King of Israel. What was Nathanael doing under that fig tree that would cause this conversion in him and to believe that Jesus was this coming Messiah? We don't know. Our brains can go, oh, what was Nathanael doing? He was obviously doing something. Was he in the Word? Was he studying? Obviously, he did that a lot. We wonder what he was actually doing, but he was doing something so precise. I hesitate to mention, but the series The Chosen paints a picture of Nathanael sitting under that fig tree, that he was contemplating something else. We don't know what's actually true. We don't know where Nathanael was at. All we know is whatever he was doing there was so significant that all Jesus had to say, hey, I saw you. I know what you were doing. I know where you're at. And that was enough for him, after studying the Scriptures, to call Jesus, not just Rabbi, not just the Son of God, but the King of Israel. In this, Nathanael covers the Old Testament, of how Jesus was going to come, the Son of God incarnate, and be that King of Israel, that lineage of David to carry on the throne. So, Jesus gives us the first of the next, Jesus gives us the first of 25 double truths we see through the book of John. So whenever we see these words, it says, hey, this is important. Listen. And so they literally mean amen, amen. So every time you read truly, truly, Jesus reveals truths worthy of being believed, even though they may at first sound incredible, that these weren't real. But it says here, truly, truly, I say to you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of God, on the Son of Man. So Jesus is saying he is the only ladder to heaven. Jesus is the only way. Acts 4:12. Maybe, you know, he's talking with Nathanael. We got to go Old Testament. There's a ladder in the Old Testament with Jacob in Bethel where he saw the angels ascending and descending on a ladder. Jesus is this ladder. And Jesus calls himself here the Son of Man. So we have seen 23 names of Christ in this first chapter of John. 23. But here, Jesus calls himself, he's the only one to ever call himself the Son of Man. So Jesus uses this title for himself more than any of them. The fact that in the Gospels, only Jesus uses this name for himself, and it indicates a significance that God became a human so humans might be able to come to God. Christ is the only ladder to heaven, and we can only claim it if he calls us. So we can see that it takes three kinds of seekers to inherit this eternal life. We can see verse 38, 39, 43, 45, several, and so on, verses telling us that it takes three kinds of seekers for this eternal life. First, there must be the seeking soul. And then there must be a seeking Savior. And there must be a seeking saint. Are you seeking? So we can see that the disciples, they had souls that were seeking. They were truly looking for the Messiah to come. Jesus was looking. He was looking for those of whom he would call. And the seeking saint was pulled by the seeking Savior to inherit this eternal life. So do you hear Jesus calling? Do you hear him pulling you? So Jesus came and took the form of his creation, living a sinless life, and died an atoning death, so he could be resurrected and ascended on high. Most assuredly, I can tell you, he is coming back. So John 14, 6 tells us, Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. 2 Timothy 3, 15 tells us, and how from childhood you have been acquainted with the sacred writings, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. Jesus is the answer. I invite you to come and see if you are seeking, if your soul is wondering. Come and ask. Come and see, for the Lord is good, and he invites you to come and see him. We thank you, Jesus. Dear Lord, we pray, Lord, that you will just continue to convict our hearts, Lord. As we prayed already, to seek, we pray that you open our eyes to hear and our eyes to see. We thank you that you bless and guide, that you, Lord, are above all else. We thank you that you came, took the form of your creation, and died, and rose again, and promised to prepare that place for us. Lord, we think of that. We think ahead. We pray, Lord, that you will just continue to work in us, work in our hearts. This Christmas season, that you would be our focus. All glory to Christ alone. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Brody. I invite you to stand as we respond to the Word of God through these next few songs and worship him with gladness and the Spirit and truth revealed.
Oh,
In the darkness, we were willing, without hope, without light, to the moment you came on, there was mercy in your eyes, to fulfill the law of God, to a virgin came the word, from the throne of endless glory, to a cradle in the world.
Sing this out, praise the Father.
Praise the Father, praise the Father.
thank you again for joining us this morning. We thank you in person, online. We thank you that you are here. We pray that you will go forth this week. Dig into his word. Build that relationship with Jesus. We go to Romans 16, 25 through 27. Now to him who is able to strengthen you according to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ, according to the resurrection of the mystery that was kept secret for long ages, but has now been disclosed, and through the prophetic writings has been made known to all nations, according to the command of the eternal God, to bring all the obedience of faith. To the only wise God be glory forever through Jesus Christ. Amen. You are loved.